presentation of NCAA basketball is presented by Bud Light. For the great taste that will fill you up and never lets you down, make it a Bud Light. And in part by Kia Motors. It's about time everyone had a well-made car.
Syracuse is eight. As someone who's been in this building for a bunch of these, it's like the old days. Hi, everyone. Mike Tirico, Len Elmore. Glad you are with us. Well, the rivalry hasn't been the same because it's the first time both teams are ranked against each other since 96. We asked Craig Eschrick this morning at the shoot-around, is it still a rivalry? And he said, heck yeah, it's still a rivalry.
Well, the rivalry does continue. You recall last March, Syracuse came into the Big East tournament the number one seed. Georgetown knocked them out, an unheralded Georgetown team, after Syracuse had beaten them six consecutive times. The thing that makes a rivalry is that the players who are there, they never forget.
No, they don't. And the Syracuse guys remember what happened in the Garden last week. Craig Eschrick has returned the equity in the basketball name Georgetown. You weren't sure if it was going to happen when he replaced John Thompson. It has.
Well, Georgetown not expected to be where they are in the polls or in the Big East standings. Eschrick's done a great job of managing depth and keeping young players happy. Jim Boeheim, probably his best coaching job, I think, in his career. Only six deep. He does a great job of keeping them in games.
Here are your starting lineups. Boeheim's Orangemen start the same five they've started the last half dozen games. Griffin Williams, Shumpert Brown have started every game. Jeremy McNeil has started since Billy Seelig had an academic problem in January. Seelig's back on the team. Braswell's a true point guard. Hunter at the two. Riley and Sweetney, freshman forwards. Ruben Boomche Boomche at 7 feet inside. They'll go 10, 11 deep. Lenny's keys to the game.
Well, the first key, Georgetown, this is a team that's got tremendous depth. They have to come at Syracuse with waves and wear Syracuse down. Syracuse with a short bench. The Orangemen got to hold their own on the boards. Georgetown out-rebounds opponents by 13. If Syracuse loses the battle on the boards, they lose the game.
Tim Higgins, Bob Donato, Andre Patillo, the officials tonight. Syracuse the home right, Georgetown in the blue, and Big Monday presented by Bud Light is underway on a nice warm night. It's 33 degrees in Syracuse, and there's no snow.
It's a balmy 32.
Damone Brown comes across the lane. Drive the inside pass for McNeil. Many times from the shot clock. Shumpert. Jumper is rounded out, and the rebound from Mike Sweetney, the freshman.
Damone had the board covered, though. Just couldn't get a hand on it while it was on the rim.
Boomche, Boomche inside. Georgetown, big size advantage in this game. Shumpert the rebound. Rebounding a big key for Syracuse tonight.
That's right. If that's any indication, then it's one and out for Georgetown. Syracuse will take that every trip.
Allen Griffin, the point guard, and the shooting slump was doubled.
Small forwards and too quick for the big guys. Georgetown trying to play Damone Brown with some big people. He's going to get around him every time and make something happen.
Sweetney catches, blocked by McNeil, but it's goaltending. First hoop of the night for Mike Sweetney, the 6'8 freshman.
Well, you take a look right here. Look how deep Sweetney is right there in the paint in front of Damone Brown. If there's any drawback, Brown a little frail compared to Sweetney. But then again, at 245, I'm frail.
Sweetney was 300 pounds and has come down to that current program weight of 260. Full guard matchup, senior Griffin, junior Braswell, both doing a good job of taking care of the ball in the last month and a half. Sean Williams, front rim, and then Boomche Boomche comes down. Sweetney kept it alive, but it was taken away by the sophomore DeShaun Williams. Tied at two, 2 minutes in. Shumpert. The triple, Williams chased it down.
To watch Syracuse play, except for Allen Griffin, this is primarily a perimeter-oriented team. Not too many guys like to put it on the floor and take it to the basket and looking for precise execution, looking for jump shots, open jump shots. Hence, they don't get to the line nearly as much as they could.
Opponents get to the line five times more per game than Syracuse. the nation. I always look at that stat because of Duke, Mike Krzyzewski. Their teams always have more attempts, or more makes, I should say, than the opponent's attempts. Like Syracuse, you're surprised to see -5 in that column.
And on a consistent basis, if you're going to stay at the top, you need to get easy opportunities. You need to get the other team in foul trouble.
Williams missed. McNeil, aggressive rebound.
Jim Boeheim was sorely long to get on track. Jeremy McNeil with an awful lot of talent. Very athletic, excellent defensive player. You can give them something in the middle. It bodes well for the arm.
Georgetown using its size against the 2-3 zone. On the interior thus far, their first three possessions. Demetrius from the bottom. Braswell faked the three. In recovery, defensive help from Sean Williams with 5 to shoot.
Into the hole right there, nobody next to him, not even close. Anthony Perry a little bit late, but that's why Damone Brown is the X factor. He gives you so much.
Free throw from the 6'9" senior from Buffalo. On the north end of the Syracuse campus, up on the Fieldhouse, where the Orangemen had won 57 in a row. They were playing their final regular season game ever in Manly in 1980. But Craig Shelton, Sleepy Floyd, stopped the Louie and Bowie show of Louis Orr and Roosevelt Bowie. Georgetown snapped the 57-game win streak of Syracuse. And as you look at Manly Fieldhouse tonight, on that night, John Thompson said, post-game quote, Manly Fieldhouse is officially closed. And that's where the seed for this rivalry was built, and it germinated 3 miles on the other side of campus here in the Carrier Dome. Often crowds of 30,000 plus. Tonight we have well over 20,000 on hand. The added rivalry influence, the two good records of these teams, their hot starts this season. Off the timeout, Braswell missed. Bucce came away with it. And Damone Brown rebounds for Syracuse. On the push, Shumpert.
Kicking it out on all cylinders again, controlling the boards, getting out and running every opportunity.
The long arm to Brown, not that away. Third Hoyas turnover.
And you see, uncharacteristically,
gives you an advantage going to the basket. And Shumpert has a chance for a three-point play. Out of the timeout, Preston Shumpert will hop in his step.
Well, again, you see how quickly the ball gets out. The first pass is always the most important in the fast break. Preston Shumpert running wide. And again, here on the drive, we talk about Preston Shumpert as a consistent scorer. I mean, this is a guy that's done a great job throughout his career. You look at him averaging about 20 points a year. He's gone from role player to feature player. And he's worked on every aspect of his game. Last year, just a jump shooter. This year, an all-around player.
He has 7 of the Orange 12. Georgetown with the size advantage. Syracuse doing it in the paint.
And it's primarily been the pressure on the wings and on the ball handle, the double and triple teams, not allowing Georgetown to get it where they want it, except right there.
It's appropriate that the hometown of Mike Sweetney's Oxon Hill, Merrill. He is an ox. I mean, he is so strong. He's a freshman. He developed the body of an upperclassman.
And he's really giving Georgetown a lift. I mean, it's one of those young players that's coming with offensive skills. In the old days, Georgetown used to get defensive players and try to teach them offense.
Oh, a spectacular move by Brown. He made like a pretzel to make the basket. It's as much energy as I've seen out of Syracuse to start a game this year. Bad pass. Griffin down. Well, they say Braswell touched it first, thus over and back.
Good hustle by Braswell to stop that fast break. Take a look at Sweetney inside. He will not be denied. Using that big body well and clearing people out. But again, Georgetown does not have an answer for Damone Brown. He keeps finding spaces where his teammates can find him, and certainly the acrobatics.
I hope Damone has a good pro career because he's going to need custom-made dress shirts. They don't sell many with a sleeve life like that. Shumpert on the take. Brown has the rebound, 20 feet away. 6.5 minutes. No one's gotten off the Syracuse bench.
Georgetown extending their defense, their man-to-man, a little bit more right now, hoping with Lee Scruggs on Damone Brown to kind of slow the Syracuse attack.
Shumpert came back to help Wesley Wilton inside. This is the first of three on Big Monday, presented by Bud Light. Our second game, we'll see number 3 Kansas take on Missouri. Heated border rivalry will come your way from Columbia. And then right after SportsCenter at midnight, check out our friends in the Mountain West, Utah BYU, the battle on the hill. Good hoops coming up tonight on ESPN.
What was that song? I think written by Donnie Hathaway, sung by Roberta Flack, Killing Them Softly.
Mm-hmm.
That's what Kansas has been doing. Not a lot of fanfare. They just keep winning.
Got a chance to see them. A month ago now against Tulsa, they were awesome. They've been so good. Hawkins lead at the early line is 10 for the Orangemen at the 7-minute mark on by first half. Denying the interior passes. Although Georgetown able to keep this possession alive. Scrubs on the 5-minute for Shattuck on the baseline. He stepped out. Kansas is number 3 in the nation as they head into their matchup. Syracuse here is number 8, Georgetown 13. Big East well represented in the top 25. We'll show that. Here's a lot. Griffin gets around the bigger scrubs. Out of bounds off Damone Brown. And we alluded to the new ESPN USA Today coaches poll. There you see 5 Big East reps in the top 25. I think if I was voting coming in, I would have Georgetown at 8 and Syracuse at 13. Thus far in the Big East season, Georgetown's been the better team. And you see the Orangemen the lone representative in the top 10.
I think the only argument against that, not that Syracuse, their schedule was that strong, but Georgetown's was pretty weak coming into a conference play. But none of that matters because the conference play.
Damone Brown anticipates and makes the steal. Possession arrow, Georgetown ball.
Well, it's really been the perimeter pressure on the passers that's really helped the interior guys for Syracuse to gamble on the passes. We've seen a couple of times now big people along the back line of the T3 zone stepping in, making interceptions. It's very easy to do.
coming.
Well, we talk about pressure on the passer. Watch Mike Sweetney go to that short corner right there to receive. Now watch the attention he draws right there. You see the double team right here, and look at Damone Brown. He steps in, recognizing the pressure on the passer. Very difficult for Sweetney to make that pass if he can't see. And that's what Syracuse has been doing for the better part of this evening, whether it's down on that short corner or tee or out on the perimeter. They've been making it very difficult for the trigger man to see his target.
And a fabulous start in the game, Len, for Preston Shumpert. Now has 11 points. Georgetown's using their bench. Syracuse's starters have built a 13-point lead. All these teams ranked in the Big East at a certain point this year. It's been an unpredictable last month or so in the league, hasn't it?
Well, it certainly has. We were talking earlier today, and we wanted to at least bet on, and not with money, but bet on who was going to win the Big East tournament. And all you can do is close your eyes and put your finger down on the standings. It could be just about anybody. That's how close these teams are.
Impossible to get a good read on who's even the chalk favorite to get the top couple of seeds in New York. They were 5 weeks away from the tournament, but it's been an unpredictable month in the conference.
And it couldn't have been money, right?
Burton stepped on the baseline. Syracuse gets it back, looking to add to this run that really has come mostly off its defense. Hoyas turnovers. Georgetown has 7 turnovers and 6 points.
Georgetown decides to try something different now. They've opened up in kind of a 2-3 or 2-1-2 zone.
Stay with Syracuse and a fresh shot clock as well.
Well, that sequence really epitomizes what's going on right now. Syracuse is battling. You watch them on the board. Here's Damone Brown, the guy they're looking for. Again, utilizing their quickness against bigger guys. And look at the battle right there. Jeremy McNeil stepping in, keeping it alive.
Sophomore Wesley Wilson comes in. He's 50 in the paint for Georgetown. As Bunche takes a seat, Wilson's seen more playing time. Bunche very limited in performance against Notre Dame. The trap is handled. Shumpert. McNeil battles for the ball. It's off the Syracuse center, and it's Georgetown ball.
And we said it earlier in the game, Jim Boeheim's got to be happy with McNeil's effort. Came up empty that time, but just the battle on the board to keep it alive is sending a message to the Georgetown front line that you can see nothing.
Sweetney gave up his dribble. Nice cut by Hunter. Used his body to shield McNeil away.
Good recognition that time. Again, under control. It's something that Georgetown has really developed, the patience and the good judgment. The offensive rebounding of Georgetown against that zone right now. They've got to pick that up in order to get back into this basketball game.
Jeremy McNeil gets a good hand for his effort, and Carrier Dome's favorite, Billy Sheila, comes in. The first substitution for Syracuse at the 10-20 mark. Time gone by.
Highly illustrative of the difference in the two benches and the depth. Georgetown already, obviously, with 8 substitutions. They're throwing waves at Syracuse. Hopefully, this will be a war, as far as they're concerned, a war of attrition.
I can guarantee you, I haven't seen every Syracuse-Georgetown game, but I've seen the majority of them. There's never been a 10-minute stretch with no team fouls. Syracuse had one there. They just picked up their first foul.
Thank you!
Sean Williams cannot find the basket right now. He's rushing his shots, and also a team. Hoyas' chance to get back to single digits.
season. Sweetney inside. He'll get to the free throw line. Very aggressive going at Sela. 7 foot string being center.
Again, the good thing about it, we talked about it many times. I talked about good judgment by Georgetown. They recognize the score. They recognize the crowd and the emotion here, but they don't seem to be in panic mode right now. It's, a lot has to do with Kevin Braswell's demeanor right here. He's still leading this team. Instead of going back to his basic roots as a scorer, of which he was a tremendous scorer, he's still trying to get everybody involved, trying to run and develop some rhythm, because he believes his team can stay in this thing.
You're watching Big Monday, presented by Bud Light. We're in the Carrier Dome, Syracuse, New York. It's where the old Big East rivalry, the calling card for this league, Syracuse, Georgetown. Off the deflection by Sela, the Syracuse center.
Vince Scruggs playing rubber band on that one. Nice little double clutch. You don't expect to see that from a guy that's 6'11", but then again, you don't expect to see a 6'11 guy shoot as well as he does from three.
Quick, Dwayne, 13. Heading towards the free throw line now for Syracuse. DeShaun Williams to the seat. These couple of bad shots.
Georgetown continues to toy with the defense. Man-to-man one trip, zone the next trip.
Great pass by Sela. Shumpert couldn't help. Shumpert's taken 13 shots, but he has 14 points left.
Well, it's the marvel again of a guy, as he's seeing Paul his own number right here, calling a play for himself. A guy goes from role player to feature player. It's the old screen to screener. He screens Scruggs, and then Damone Brown gives him a nice pick to dissuade his defender from coming out and getting him. And again, you talk about a guy who's grown a lot. I mean, that's what Preston Shumpert really illustrates, the ability for guys to push their game beyond what you think they are. And last year, you thought he was a nice role player, shooting jump shots to go along with the three seniors in Hart and Tom Thomas and Ryan Blackwell. And now he's a guy that's going to step up and lead him
in. Georgetown, good aggressive pressure here. Broke it nicely by Brown, right to the cup. Coming to the free throw line. Brown and Shumpert give you so much because of their body type. And if you look at the Syracuse team that's out there now with Dwayne, Sela the center, Damone Brown, those three that are out there now. Long arms, and they make the zone on the other end, on the defensive end, not passive, but difficult.
Well, they certainly do. They cut down on the passing lanes. The thing I spoke about when I mentioned Preston Shumpert's development, there it is right there, as graphic as you can get. Doubled his production just about in both of those categories. And again, it just comes down to hard work, waiting for your opportunity.
Well, Brown has two. We mentioned it going to break. Shumpert and Brown. 21 of the Syracuse 23. Hoyas are the top scoring team in the Big East at 83 a game. Right now they're sitting on a dozen.
There are those arms, Mike, you were talking about.
Demone Brown. Rainey lost it. turtle jump. Super Tuesday, part of Rivalry Week, presented by New York Life. Number 5, Michigan State will come on into Ann Arbor, down 23 to take on Michigan. And then Tennessee and Florida, ranked number 7 to 14, looks like football promo, basketball. Very good doubleheader. Rivalry Week continues here on ESPN. Boy, to get off to a great start Saturday. UMass and Temple, Maryland, Duke continues here tonight. Includes Duke, North Carolina later on in the week. Tennessee, Connecticut, the greatest rivalry in women's college basketball right now. Should be a great week of hoops. This is the week, Lenny, after the Super Bowl, where the rest of the sports world turns its attention to what's been going on in college hoops. You're going to find, I think, a lot of good teams, a couple of very good teams, in a very tough to figure landscape right now.
Exactly. A number of teams that people would have never believed would be as competitive as they are.
Like the Syracuse team, Len alluded to before, lost 3 seniors who were very solid contributors for 3 or 4 years. They filled in some missing pieces, doing a nice job thus far, building their record to 16-3. Double dribble on Demetrius Hunter.
Good call by the officials. Hunter had it under control. Picked it up and dribbled again. You take a look. The 3 seniors from last year that I spoke of, the heart and soul of this team. And as I said, Jim Boeheim has put pieces into that puzzle to replace those guys. You know, he's gotten role players to develop. And now the main guys are Griffin, Shumpert, Damone, and they've stepped up nicely.
Williams off the bench after the throw sabbatical. First shot is a missed 3. 3 Syracuse players defending. Craig Eschrick screaming for the foul. Syracuse only has 3 fouls in 14 minutes. And he's saying that is impossible. Strikes a triple. Players are ice cold. 5 of 17 shooting. And they turn it over for the 12th time. Horrible first half offensively for Georgetown. Brinkman goes all the way. Syracuse ball. Must be attributed in some respects to Syracuse's defense.
Well, certainly not a very good sequence that time. Craig Eschrick calling for a foul when Sweetney grabbed a rebound last time was doubled by Syracuse. You give Syracuse defense a lot of credit. Again, the double team, the harassment. And now Georgetown is going back, kind of back to form, rushing a little bit. You look at the turnovers, 12 thus far.
Pointy's defense on this end is keeping them in its town. Wesley Wilson comes in for Mike Sweetney.
The other half of that stat, as far as turnovers concerned, only 4 for Syracuse. You expect that from them. Conference low 13 turnovers per game.
Keep hearing Williams. That's right. And the tip back in. I think Sealick's going to get it. Very close to still being in the cylinder. 13-point Syracuse lead. Doubling the Hoyas, who are 5 of 17 shooting. Braswell comes out top. And DeShaun nothing going on for Georgetown right now. Braswell, great, tricky dribble. Shumpert met him, but scrubs.
Trying to attack the gap in the zone. He's got to be more offensive-minded right now because that zone is flattening out at the top, daring him to shoot the 3.
And he can be more offensive-minded. Was a 2-guard last year. Sealick. Shumpert ball fake. Top shot. Over 6'11", Wesley Wilson, who stretched out every inch of his reach.
That's the kind of shot that might get you to the next level. Mid-range jump shot under control. And if you recognize on offense, Syracuse doing a lot of ball faking, looking for the Georgetown aggressive defenders to bite.
Scrubs the rebound, knocked away. For whatever reason, when the bell rang, the whole team answered it. Preston Shumpert is 16. And the Orangemen lead by 13 on Big Monday, presented by Bud Light. Michael Graham and company, one championship on the way to another in Seattle when they won the national championship. That was in 1984. There's the Syracuse star from that team here in the building tonight, Dwayne Pearl Washington. It was good to see Pearl, who does some local radio in town and also is an assistant coach at Onondaga Community College and is enjoying that a little bit.
I'm telling you, at Syracuse, Georgetown, what's the first thing that comes to mind? And he said, they always had big guys in the middle.
And he found every single one of them, too. But Pearl was one of those guys, man, that could make things happen, darting through the lane, creating for other guys, lean on you, make shots.
Mm-hmm. 3 years, then left after his junior year, first-round draft pick of the New Jersey Nets. Didn't have the NBA career that he would have hoped, but was a great college player. Off the timeout, Riley's three was well off. Georgetown's net, Burton takes down the rebound. Burton, a role player on this team. You need that with your scores, but right now, the young scorers are not getting it done. And a mistake by the sophomore in his first year of playing, Wesley Wilson.
Wilson expected Scruggs to roll down from the top, where he might have been open had he thought about it.
Georgetown looks as though they have the rebound, and they knock it away from each other. Take a look at the Syracuse bench. They like it. But the problem, again, is the question of Georgetown trying to do too much and essentially wind up with nothing to show for it.
Travel courtyard by Marriott halftime report. Chris and Digger in the studio, Sports Center in game. Butch Davis leaving the Big East and heading to Cleveland. And the Ravens, the old Browns, return home champions after the Super Bowl yesterday in Tampa. Turnover 15. Well, I saw one good defensive show yesterday by the Ravens. Syracuse's defense is being aided by Georgetown's offensive struggle in the first half, at least. Here's a defensive wrinkle. They track. Scruggs forced the shot. Georgetown will have 15.7 to shoot with the shot clock off. Syracuse has two fouls to give. They only have four team fouls here. And Jim Boeheim's going to take his 30-second timeout. And I bet you he's going to get guys in there who don't have many fouls, although nobody on the team has more than one, to use a couple of these fouls. Rivalry Week presented by New York Life will continue with an important Big East game tomorrow. Connecticut and St. John's, and then Dayton Xavier, a little state of Ohio battle. So that's your ESPN2 College Week lineup as Rivalry Week presented by New York Life continues. What's the point you made before about the preseason picks in each side, the West and East of the Big East?
Well, Connecticut in the East and Seton Hall in the West were the preseason picks for number one, and they're both in fifth place. You know, so go figure.
Here are the Huskies at 2-4, 13-6. The lead is a couple of big wins. Braswell thought about the three. Hunter found in this fire. Shumpert chased it down. Griffin saw the block. Syracuse tried to squeeze off one more. Griffin. Was 16. The break lead will be 15. Shumpert and Brown, both in the top eight in scoring in the Big East. 29 of the Syracuse 37 at the half. The Cuse by 15. Leading scores first half. Preston Shumpert, Syracuse 18. Eight for Kevin Braswell on two threes. Four of the Hoyas. The crowd 21,054.
This is their bread and butter right now. They're going to get back into this ball game. It begins with a number of consecutive stops.
And Brown, who had 11 in that first half. Preston Shumpert at 18. Shumpert had 10 20-plus point games this year. Forced that one. And on the hook here, Braswell. Williams chasing. Second chance, Riley. He'll get to the free throw line.
And you look at Georgetown on the offensive glass, and I talked about finishing. That just wasn't a good play. And you take a look at the opportunities here. Second chance points. Syracuse with eight right here. And certainly only two by Georgetown. And you just saw an example of why they haven't been able to score. Riley just didn't go up strong, even though he gets to the free throw line.
The foul was on Allen Griffin. His second. Syracuse only committed, or only was whistled, for 14 fouls in that first half. Your view of the game. Riley, a good shooter, and may in the future be a two guard. And now plays that 2-3 wing roll for the Hoyas.
The other key stat there is Georgetown 15 turnovers.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you've got to be able to value the basketball to maximize opportunity. Georgetown doesn't shoot well enough to give away the ball.
The foul on Riley was his second. No one has more than two fouls in the game. Syracuse's starting five is on the floor. Damone Griffin, the senior point guard. DeShaun Williams is backcourt mate. Long ground, Preston Shumpert, Jeremy McNeil. He'll share the center time with Billy Seeley. Shumpert lost his man. Missed the three. McNeil and Bunchik. Bunchik over the deck. Williams came away with it.
Georgetown getting in their way. It's on the way again. But this time, it works out for them.
Bradley on the way. And finish. McNeil deflected it. Sweetney and Bunchik. Bunchik took it away from each other. Their rebound margin.
Syracuse is dead even. They get as many boards as their opponents. Syracuse, even though they were 3,000 miles away in the warmth of California. Here you see Syracuse, Georgetown, St. John's, the three all-time winningest programs in conference play. Syracuse and Georgetown, 1-2. Scrubs comes back in. Hillier takes a seat, so he had his 1 minute and 2 points.
Pushes the ball up floor is that he looks up floor. A lot of guys are looking down at the ball, looking for their opening instead of looking ahead for cutters.
Yeah. Where is the Shumpert, top 10 free throw shooter in this conference, just under 80%.
Riley comes back in. Matt Burton takes a seat, so does Braswell. Syracuse's 20 games that he has gone over the 20-point mark, and that is a shocking stat. 28-16 points in the paint. Syracuse's advantage in that stat.
Well, they've been able to get some fast break opportunities off the but it was definitely appropriate to say that the intensity of Georgetown defense is great. Mm-hmm. You see that with a lot of teams where they get down and they really try to play. They may not be successful all the time, but they definitely make a commitment.
Foul on Burton was his third. Second in 5 seconds, but most importantly, the Hoyas. 17 fouls, and Syracuse will get a lot of free throws from Jim Boeheim, who's heard enough that his team's a poor free throw shooting team.
He's going to hear it one more time?
No, he's going to hear that his team's at 72.7% leading the Big East. Rare that you've heard that in the same sentence as best free throw shooting team.
Sweetney.
Shumpert got an open there. He's missed. Three free throws this half.
That time Sweetney put a body on somebody.
Syracuse leads by 10. Fans in the Carrier Dome very fond of the players who gave it their all during their years here at Syracuse, and one of them was honored at halftime. Conrad McCray, who passed away with a heart attack as he was trying to get back in the NBA. He played in Europe, was trying to be a part of the Orlando Magic. Age 29, his mom and sister were here, and one of the university officials presented Conrad McCray to his mother. Halftime of the game here. He's trying to give the NBA one last shot. He's number 13, framed and a replica given to his mom in a very moving ceremony at halftime. A warm feeling ceremony which befit Conrad, who had a great energy and smile about him. And it's been a tough time for the whole world of college basketball. We certainly pass along our thoughts to the folks involved with the tragedy at Oklahoma State and the memory of Al McGuire. All of us who watch college basketball and are a part of it from a television standpoint owe a great debt of gratitude to Al. And our thoughts are with those families and the Oklahoma State entire community as well. You know, Syracuse played Oklahoma State 2 years ago in the NCAA tournament. And last year, Eddie Sutton's team was up here in the dome for their opening round in the regional. So a lot of the people in his athletic department who work this regional got to know the Oklahoma State folks quite well. Very difficult time for them as well. And all of us who have come across those folks over the years.
We talk about the impact on the community there. It's all the college basketball community. We lost some of the great losses here.
Absolutely.
But we do have the memories, and that's what you're holding on to. You think about guys like Conrad McCray, a big chiseled body, rough style guy inside with a heart of gold. Always had a smile.
Help ball, possession arrow to the Hoyas. Shumpert and Wilson went after it.
Yeah, I remember Al McGuire. It was my biggest disappointment. He came to my high school recruit. I thought he was looking at me, but he told me, "You live in Queens, you got grass in your front yard. I'm looking for a guy by the name of Ed Searcy."
Is that what he told you?
Who lived in Harlem in the project. That was the guy he wanted.
Braswell got close and forced the free throws. Good shot by Braswell. You were such a great part of the New York City scene in high school basketball. I always joke, you know, high school legend, but you truly were. Al was a guy who really embodied what New York City basketball was all about and kept it going in his days at Marquette with the pipeline there.
Well, he was funny and he was brutally honest, which you always appreciate, especially the kids back then. And, you know, again, all of television broadcasting, sports broadcasting, owes Al a debt of gratitude because he began the basketball lexicon with prime time and aircraft carrier. And he just kind of hoped he's got a few aircraft carriers playing for his CYO team up there.
It'll be an ESPN Classic tribute to Al McGuire on Thursday, so look forward to that. Here it is, Georgetown cutting it to single digits for the first time in at least 20 minutes. It's 48-40. Syracuse has gone quiet and moderately stagnant on the offensive end as Georgetown's defensive pressure has turned up. And they're finding ways to the free throw line. But Dwayne in the game. Austin Hunter's playing good defense. He's on the move. It's the Jeffers. Sweetney crashed the glass. Almost had the three-point play, but he shot free throws, and the Hoyas can get within six.
And that's been the little tweak that Georgetown has to make. They're doing all the effort thing. They just have to be able to finish. Take a look at the good defense. Here's the break. Hunter with the pretty good decision to take the shot. He knows he's got his board covered. And there's Sweetney. The one thing you got to recognize now, here's where the depth of Georgetown starts to take over. They're quicker to the board. Their defensive pressure has now taken the energy out of the legs of the Syracuse ball handlers. And it's starting to take its toll overall.
Sweetney starting to show some of the leadership and some confidence in this team. Within seven. Home crowd knows it too. He's trying to urge the Orangemen on.
But we've got emotion at the shot of adrenaline for their team because they slowly start to wear down. And as Georgetown continues to play this pressure defense, not only do you wear down physically, but you also wear down mentally.
Syracuse gone small here the last few trips. No center in the game. Eight to shoot. Brown, a great defender. Griffin tried his crossover. Brown lost it.
That's the two.
Long return. And numbers two for a second. Hunter straight. He wants it. Braswell took it himself, and then he got fouled. On the way up, it'll be a couple of free throws.
Yeah, talk about mental fatigue again. The inability to just handle the ball in close situations. Damone Brown in the first half had his way off the dribble. He's played a lot of minutes right now, and it's starting to take its toll.
Here's for Braswell. 6-point game. The Hoya shuttle continues. This has always been the case in these teams during their heyday. Bayham likes to have eight. Georgetown has always flooded you with 10 or 11. But in this game, the Syracuse bench is shorter. The pace and style fits the Hoyas a little bit here in the second half. And at the halfway point, what was a halftime deficit of 15 is now 5.
That was the celebration to nonstop.
That's the expression of April, isn't it? Of course, she said who's going to climb.
That's because we're going someplace.
Georgetown momentum, the Hoyas in an ugly way gotten it to five.
Well, Mike, you made a good point about Syracuse trying to do it on their own. The reason is the Georgetown defense has taken them out of their rhythm, taken them out of the set, and when the time starts running down, guys try to create on their own. And again, when you're tired, you're going to have a lot of difficulty handling the ball and going places you want to go. That's why I call it the nonstop
rather than the express. Instead of taking the 30, Syracuse made this their full timeout. You do have the option of making one of your timeouts a 60. So they'll stop it for a minute.
Let your voice be heard.
The invasion of Mount Snow, Vermont. Winter X Games 2001. All the best in the world.
Pal Susie Copper will host the Winter X Games from Mount Snow up in Vermont starting Friday night on ESPN, ESPN2, ABC, coverage throughout the week. The Winter X Games.
Okay.
Kansas and Missouri coming up next. Ron Franklin, John Sundholm, we'll bring that to you from Missouri. A chance to see number three Kansas not being talked about in the same conversation as Michigan State. We'll see tomorrow on ESPN at Stanford and Duke. We'll see later in the week on ESPN. We're cranking out some good games here this week. 21,000 and change here in the dome tonight. They watch their home team. They only attempt 8 shots in the first 10, 25.
Tell you what, I think there's a rule, particularly in the Big East, but certainly between these two guys. If you're out, if the ball's on the floor, if all five guys aren't on the floor, somebody's coming out.
But we talked about how we was a little bit surprised that Georgetown was even with Syracuse rebounding-wise in the first half. In the second half, it's starting to change a little bit. Syracuse is helping the cause.
Well, certainly, there's no mystery why this deficit is closed. It's been the rebounding of Georgetown. It's been their extended defense forcing these turnovers, not only physically forcing them, but certainly in the unforced category. It's a mental error made by Syracuse. So, you know, you've got both working there.
Syracuse has two left. Georgetown has three. One of the Georgetown three. All 60. The whole ball kept to Syracuse after Shumpert in possession. Five going to score. Brown has it. Backs it up.
Well, he thought better of it. Seeing Wesley Wilson back there. Good decision by Brown. They get his team set. Let him try to run their set.
He came off the screen, but couldn't make the catch. Here is Riley with Braswell. Hunter, who went up and Griffin went up with him. Should have been intentional. And a technical foul is called, I believe, on Georgetown, an ejection by Tim Higgins. I don't know who or why, but we'll find out in a moment. Hunter wanted the intentional foul. Higgins did not call it. Hunter was angry the way it was taken down, went right up, chest bumped Griffin. I didn't see if anything else happened. Craig Estrick immediately ran out to his player, but after they broke free, Higgins tossed, I believe, Braswell, is what we're hearing from the other side.
Well, if it is Braswell, huge blow for Georgetown, and quite honestly, you wonder why Braswell even got his nose into it.
The officials, if it's considered a fight, quote unquote, can consult the replay. Wilson is the player who's ejected. Wesley Wilson. Now, perhaps Wesley, I'm going a little bit through the back of my mind here. If Wilson was not on the floor and came out on the floor, that would be a reason.
And I would tend to agree with you simply because, again, I mean, you see Hunter, he got up and, you know, visibly and obviously mad about the play, but really that was probably enough ammunition to have a tee, but not for a toss. Now, again, I didn't see anybody else grabbing. I didn't see anybody else getting into it to the extent where it warranted an ejection.
We'll show it to you in a second. It is called a contact technical, which brings ejection from the game. They've classified technical fouls this year.
Well, there's the foul right there, and that looked like, you know, pretty much intentional. And there's Hunter stepping in, and really, hands were down at the side. It was just kind of touching chest.
Let's see if we see Wilson come in. There we see him come into the picture from behind.
All right, looks like it's all broken up.
That's his third. But two free throws will be shot at the Georgetown end of the court.
I don't know what Wilson
technical
did
foul
there.
And ejection called on number 50, Wesley Wilson. Two free throws will be shot at the other end of the court, and Syracuse gets possession.
Tim Higgins is the official who made the decision. And Tim made it right away, which leads me to believe that he had to say something. Well, Tim Higgins is not he's not a quick trigger guy. He's not going to run somebody from the game. Might call a tee. Not going to run somebody from the game for a situation like that.
Well, Tim's a city guy. He understands the flow of the game. If Wilson had said something, it certainly had to be as he passed by Higgins, because then his back was to him. You take a look right there. As Riley asked him for it, and they're touching him. Well, we didn't have a chance to see Wilson.
Here he comes.
Now there's Wilson. He walks past everyone. Now he's within earshot. He's past Tim Higgins before he makes the call.
Yeah. I saw that. You see, he said, I saw that, if you read Timmy's lips there. So Hunter made one of two. It's a four-point game, as close as it's been in a long time. Seventh in the league in free throws, makes his one. Now has another one coming. It obviously was miscommunicated from the other side. It was not a contact technical foul. Now it will be Syracuse ball. 50-44, 8:30 to go, as you see.
Now, if there's a bright side to it for Georgetown, and as good a player as Wilson is, they've got enough depth along the front line to kind of withstand that. Had it been Braswell, that would have been big trouble.
His third.
expect the officials to tighten this game up right now. But more importantly, that little break in the action
just thinking the same thing.
Probably gave Syracuse enough of a blow to kind of get their legs back and get their heads back into this basketball game.
It's the ninth foul on George. Eight on Syracuse. He's in the act, so Brown will get two. And he now has 14 points on the night.
Well, if you thought about it, I thought about it. It's like great minds think alike.
Or it was so obvious, we didn't need to say it because everybody at home thought it. Brown hits both. Lead back up to eight. And was four just a few seconds ago.
I'm trying to subscribe to the form.
It's not 30,000, but it's loud. A lot of the fans on their feet will let you come to the dome for this possession.
Job by Riley to get himself set on the weak side of the court. And Georgetown can't allow themselves to discontinue the physical play just because of that last altercation. They've got to continue to be the aggressor and play the official decision to try to tighten up the ball game.
One more coming for Riley. We talked about Syracuse being a good free throw shooting contest. With more fouls being called, it'll come to light that Georgetown is full. 65% free throw shooting team. Riley missed them both. Three to the ground. Hoyas come away with it.
And even though they're a bad free throw shooting team, they always find a way to neutralize it.
Like Braswell, hustling to get the loose ball, making the two. It's a 6-point game. Full court pressure. The foul on Samuel. You hit it right on the head. It's every touch is a whistle now.
And you can't blame the officials. In their attempt to try to keep this game under control, they've got to send a message right now, and players have to understand. You know, it's going to be about hustle. You can't put your hands on guys. You can't do all the things that are nagging, that are almost precipitous, so to speak, that may cause the fight.
Not only do you not blame them, you credit them for doing the right thing. Good to see Syracuse's improvement at the free throw line. 84, they were a 75% team from the line. That was the best.
Let's go, buddy.
In recent memory, they led the Big East. Boeheim in a heated discussion with Bob Donato over there. The ball was ready for play. Syracuse was not at the line. I don't know if they took away a free throw attempt. One free throw there and made it. Official timeout at the 7:34 mark. Syracuse Georgetown, same as it ever was. We're back, 7:34. Syracuse leading Georgetown by 7.
We'll take a look at Tim Higgins' arm around Alan Griffin. Now watch Wesley Wilson as he passes by. Look at his right arm right there. And watch it come up underneath, and he probably made contact with the official's arm around Alan Griffin.
It was just that little shot. It was not a punch, Tim Higgins said. He just came over and was nice enough to tell us, but he had his arm around Griffin trying to pull him out. It was the little shot, that's the shot after things were calmed down, and that's why. But it was not a punch, because there's a fighting connotation, which would carry a suspension for the first half of the next game. Sweeping inside, two-hand dunk, 5-point game.
Just to go back to that play, though, I'm not so sure that was meant with any balance. I'm not sure that Wilson would try to do something that crazy.
Williams got blocked by Sweetney, and a great play by the freshman. Touch Syracuse, Georgetown ball inside of 7 minutes. Well, Mike Sweetney's been twice the Big East Rookie of the Week. He was the Washington Post Player of the Year in high school last year. There he is on the offensive end of the impressive dunk. First dispossession after blocking the shot by Williams. Players can't get the leak out. Griffin. Thank you. conference, the Big 12. BYU after that. Williams, quick trigger, triple.
Griffin steals the ball and a nice fast break. Syracuse with new life, new legs, and a newfound sense of purpose.
Observation about this Syracuse team over the years. When they have the stars like Coleman and Owens, the expectation of Ronnie Cycling and Pearl Washington. Players because of great individual ability. A little bit of what we're seeing Seton Hall go through with some of its growing pains. Not as individually talented as those past teams. The Syracuse teams from the 96 Final Four team that lost in the championship game to Kentucky on play more emotionally together than those past era teams. And it's one of the reasons that the song is greater than the parts over the last few years for Syracuse.
And one of the big reasons has been the continuity in the program. You know, Jim Boeheim has had to have guys graduate from role players into feature players, as we talked about Preston, Shumpert, and Demone. So they didn't come in as stars.
Talking about the one-on-one matchups in this game, it could be to Syracuse's advantage at times.
We take a look at Brown right here in a triple threat position, a little ball fake, puts it on the floor. Sweetney just not quick enough. His feet aren't quick enough to stay with Damone Brown. And not only is Brown capable of making for himself, but he can certainly create for others, as he did there.
Jeremy McNeil has come on the last few games. He's not ever going to be a huge offensive factor. I shouldn't say ever, but in the near future. The sophomore from San Antonio leads this team in blocks. He only got his starting opportunity because Billy Seelig had to sit a couple of games for academic reasons. McNeil, who's now 16 of 24 from the line this year, adds a couple there. Lead is a dozen at the 5-minute mark. This group of players, the offense will come from the perimeter.
Tell you what, though, the McNeil block was impressive, but Sweetney's catching a crowd. You know, you talk about big guys, you got central. But watch Sweetney call for it right there, and he makes that catch in a crowd. And he gets hit on the arm, and the foul is called. That's one of the most important things you want in a big man. The ability to catch a crowd, the ability to catch the ball, period.
We mentioned Sweetney was a 300-pounder, came down to 260, so his body able to handle the physical rigors of his first college season, right about at that wall time now. So talented freshman will hit a little bit of a low in his season stats. Griffin, he took three! athletic coach came right out of his seat.
You think that was one of those, oh no, nice shot.
It's exactly what it was. Jim Bay and Bernie Fine have been sitting next to each other on that bench for a quarter century, 25 years. One more coming for Braswell. Neither team lighting it up from the outside.
Syracuse has really gotten a lot of miles out of the mid-range on top.
Well made two, even though the other one. He shot so soft, they would have come to the net. That was good touch.
Presentation of NCAA basketball is presented by Bud Light. For the great taste that won't fill you up and never lets you down, make it a Bud Light.
Alan Griffin's only hit 8 three-pointers this year. The last one was saved in this year's up a dozen. The final TV timeout is two timeouts remaining. Every foul from now on is 2 3 throws. Well, Syracuse and Georgetown renewing their Big East rivalry has really set the tone for the continuation of a fabulous week of basketball. Tennessee, UConn on the women's side, we mentioned. Duke, North Carolina, their first of two, what I'm sure will be epic battles, comes up this week. The game follows Kansas, Missouri. Turnover by Syracuse. Miscommunication by Shumpert and Williams. Let me tell you about tomorrow night in Ann Arbor. Tom Izzo brings Michigan State down to Chrysler Arena. Young, emotional Michigan team. In desperate need of a good home crowd, if they show up ready, we've seen Michigan can put the effort up. It might be a good game, so tune in for that one after sports in our early season.
Well, that's certainly capable of a big win against Iowa. Iowa's been doing the job in the Big Ten, so you never know what's going to happen. If you mentioned the presence of our team, they have to get them to a few minutes.
Braswell gets it to 10 in the 3-minute mark. Jim Boeheim took a little slip over there coming out of his chair. This is the 998th straight game for Jim Boeheim. He hasn't missed a practice, a game, anything since he was an assistant coach at Syracuse back here. Now 29 seasons altogether. Jim is so active in the community as well. He and his wife, Julie. You can see seeing there, they do a big cancer benefit. Syracuse's basketball program raises as much for cancer research as any school in the country. They do a big one on April 27th. They get Coach K, Neil Sedaka, people up here, and keep the money in Central New York. Jim very active and vocal in Coaches versus Cancer. They've been very successful because of Jim's efforts.
Jimmy Boeheim, for all these years, one of those 25th years, it's epitomizing what college coaching is all about. Not just between the lines.
Scruggs. Sweetney wants to hit. 9-point game. This is a better free throw shooting team. Georgetown's defense will keep you by your TV. Because Wade Kansas will back with Duke Maryland for Saturday night. 10 points against the
No, no, not shot clock, by the way. So Brown tipped it, didn't hit the rim.
scrubs the rebound. Big possession for the Hoyas. They could get it to six. Hunter shoots three.
Michael, this is game. I'm going to tell you what Syracuse playing with fire, trying to run the clock down. They're forced to go one-on-one at the top, but they don't have one-on-one dribble penetration guys except for Allen Griffin. And that'll get them in trouble.
Possession arrow goes to Syracuse.
All right, now if you're Craig Eschrick and you start to talk to your team, it's all about execution right now. It's got to be a wide open shot, got to get it inside. Create some foul situations if you can, but more importantly, if we miss, you got to go get it against this zone. That's what it reveals. You don't need three. But you do take the open shot if it presents itself.
Timeout. Each team has one.
30 seconds. Syracuse timeout.
We'll take a look at the high-low right here. There's Lee Scruggs. Look at Sweetney right inside. What the high-low does is Scruggs goes to the top. It draws the attention of the defenders and allows Sweetney to sneak from behind. You take a look in. There's McNeil goes up to Scruggs, and right behind him comes Sweetney. That's what Georgetown tried to do in the first half. He never got it going. Troy Weaver, Syracuse assistant, has done a terrific job in helping to develop these players, also in recruiting them. Started out in Pittsburgh, went on to New Mexico, and found a home here. And on the other side, again, terrific recruiter, excellent X and O guy, Ronnie Thompson, son of John Thompson. And he's done a great job in bringing some of these young players in, like Mike Sweetney, for Craig Eschrick. Both of those guys flying their trade, toiling in the vineyard. Stopped it up between some of the line. Intended. He wanted to take some time off, possibly get a turnover, but again, to knock Syracuse out of the rhythm. And you got to give the Orangemen credit for solving that thing and attacking.
This is the only timeout Georgetown hasn't used, and it happens to be their 60, so it'll be a full break. Let's watch how Syracuse broke the pressure.
Let me take a look right there. There's Shumpert, goes to the opposite side, and you see the defender come running at the ball handler, and what that did was take him out of the plane and forced everyone to have to rotate. And when you can get any type of zone or any type of press rotating, you're going to find opening.
Third assist for the night for DeShaun Williams. As you look at the game reset, only one more clock stoppage ahead. Allen Griffin has 11 assists tonight for Syracuse. Damone Brown has a double-double, his 19 points and 12 rebounds. Mike Sweetney is a double-double, 14 points with his 13 rebounds. And Brown's double-double is his 10th in 20 games for Syracuse. Leading scorers, Preston Shumpert with 23. And Braswell has 20 for the Hoyas.
We're going to go across.
At this juncture, two possession ball game, but you still don't need a three if you can get a quick two. Similar to the high-low situation with Scruggs.
Gets it right to Ron and John. Here's what done here. There's the shot off the inside for the quick two. The screen is deflected by the long arms of Brown. Shumpert on his way out, got rid of it. Brown gets fouled.
Unfortunately for Georgetown, that play developed so slowly. Even though Syracuse is in his zone, a lot of quick passing, but a lot of fumbling as well. No one ever set, no one ever in position to get off a good one.
Syracuse's best conference win was a 9-point win here in the Dome at the start of the month against Notre Dame. They have three good non-conference wins this year. Great Alaska Shootout. They beat by 8 in the first round. Their victory by 11 over Ohio State, 22 over Missouri. Team you see next. Those victories are getting better looking as the season goes on.
Let the ball bounce. Don't leave.
Brown made them both. The lead is 8. Now you gotta have 3. Braswell can do the trick. Scruggs, 5, 15.1 to go.
Yeah, that was a trick.
Follow 45. We Scruggs, 2 more
minutes. Syracuse story against teams that were ranked when they played them. One of the 3 losses to Tennessee here in the Dome by 13 on ESPN. The other 2 losses for Syracuse this year, Seton Hall, Notre Dame.
As you mentioned, right? Yeah, that top one against the ball doesn't look so good, but when you take in consideration the games that you mentioned, Ohio State and Missouri, that canceled that one out.
DePaul ranked at the time, preseason ranking, so nebulous. Syracuse was unranked preseason, and Bernie Fine, their assistant coach, took a copy of the top 25, put it in each locker before the trip to Alaska, and just wanted to let the guys know that nobody thought anything. They tipped it off to Columbia. We're going there quick. Part of the miss. Scruggs the rebound. Comes out, takes a three.